after the crisis, even a bit before, but especially after the crisis, the whole debate about economic growth really changed. And I think that there was definitely, if you want, a common understanding that it wasn't just the economy that had failed, but economics as a discipline really had a very hard time explaining the origin of the crisis, as well as knowing what to do during the crisis. But the exciting bit is actually that the whole debate about economic growth really evolved to one where we started talking about what kind of growth do we want. And these nice trendy words, which are very important words, but unfortunately have remained mainly just trendy, popped up in all sorts of places in the OECD, the UN, the European Commission, but also in national plans. And the point there was we need growth that is smart, innovation-led. We need growth that is inclusive, so actually produces less, not more inequality. And we want growth that's sustainable, which I will be focusing on different parts of that sustainability, but let's just for now say greener growth. Now, the problem is, of course, that, you know, were we actually then prepared to talk about the immense policy making and policy tools that are actually required to direct growth, to tilt the playing field, not level the playing field, in growth that is actually in, you know, this type of growth, so smart, inclusive, and sustainable? And the answer is no. And why is that? Really, because one of the biggest battles that we have and we continue to have, and I would say that since the 1980s, we increasingly have, is we have no idea how to actually talk about the economic policy process. At best, we talk about the need to create these kind of background framework conditions to level the playing field and then let the really interesting sort of private sector do their thing. We have to take away all these terrible impediments that are usually different types of taxes and make sure we're incentivizing business properly, take away red tape that we tend to see everywhere, and then somehow this miracle is gonna happen. In economics, we talk about this in terms of the need to fix different types of market failures. And, you know, there are huge market failures, and in fact, we've just lived through a massive market failure, one could say, but this way of thinking of the policymaking process as simply kind of putting bandages here and there when you have different types of market failures. For example, in my area, the economics of innovation area, the most typical market failure would be, say, the lack of private investment in basic science, because it's very hard for private firms to appropriate the returns from that, so you have underinvestment, and so you need the state to come in and sort of fix that problem, which of course is a huge problem, and we do need governments around the world if you want to be investing in basic science, and there's huge differences in terms of the degree to which countries are doing that, but seeing that as just a fixing process, as though you have this kind of market here and the policymaking process just coming in to intervene in what would be otherwise seen as some sort of a perfect, beautiful system that, again, just needs kind of managing on the sidelines, is a real problem. And I really want to focus this talk on the need for progressive parties worldwide to completely debunk this kind of lame narrative of the role of the policymaking process in the economy. And perhaps the thing that I've tried to do the most, often in a theatrical way, but I'll try to remain serious tonight so no one gets a bad reputation in terms of who's on their advisory committee, is to debunk this kind of cartoon image of, you know, the state as necessary, but a bit boring and lethargic and bureaucratic and a dinosaur and inertial, blah, 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 and the, you know, businesses as really dynamic and creative and able to think out of the box. Because actually, if you look around the world and you look at the history of capitalism, which, by the way, is recent, right? It's not a universal system that has been with us forever. It's about 300 years old. If you look at places that have actually achieved, for example, smart innovation-led growth, it actually required lots of thinking out of the box, also by the public sector. This is not public versus private, by the way. We know how to talk about the private sector. We don't know how to talk about the public sector. We've often needed that kind of creative, mission-oriented, visionary thinking in order for interesting things to happen. So I really want to convince you that perhaps one of the most important things for, again, progressive parties to do is to debunk this cartoon image, which also justifies, if you want, some actors in the economy to extract a bit too much value. And the problem is that in economics, we don't actually have, if you want, the vocabulary to talk about things that are not just, you know, market fixing. So in my own work, I kind of went back and was quite inspired by the work of a sociologist slash anthropologist slash historian. He kind of did everything. He didn't call himself an economist. Karl Polanyi, where he really very explicitly talked about this need to understand the role that the policymaking process has had in directly shaping and creating markets. He has this wonderful history of the market itself, the capitalist market, as having actually been an outcome of the policymaking process, unlike, by the way, local and international markets that have been kind of around since the ancient Greeks. The national market, he talks about, again, is historically specific, about 300 years, having been an outcome of a policymaking. But more generally, if you think of, you know, what is the market, of course it's an outcome. It's an outcome of the interactions between different types of economic agents, different types of businesses, large and small, different types of public organizations, and of course civil society, which is constantly putting pressure also on different things to happen. So as soon as you start saying markets are outcomes, it also becomes very hard to blame the market, you know, in terms of forcing, for example, short-termism on companies. Well, the market's an outcome, so let's start looking at within, for example, different sectors, which actors are actually being short-termist, which are not, which types of public agencies are, if you want, more visionary and mission-oriented and able to attract great talent and welcome the explorative process, which is so important when investing in the long run. Keynes himself, I think, actually hasn't been given enough credit for some of this kind of interesting talk. I mean, you know, think of Steve Jobs' whole thing of be hungry, be foolish, right? And then read these quotes in that sense. So Keynes said, the point of government is not just to fix things, not just to sort of tinker on the sidelines and make things a little bit better or a little bit worse, but to really be doing kind of big things that are not being done. And I guess this is the point, which is that unfortunately the way we have talked about what's not being done in the private sector has been very lame. And so hence we've also had all sorts of policies that are always focused on sort of de-risking, administering, regulating, and not actually actively pursuing alongside the private sector new types, if you want, of wealth creation and a new narrative of where wealth comes from, which should, if we actually have a proper new narrative of where wealth comes from, also then map into a different type of distribution of the fruits of that wealth, right? So instead, what we currently have, I believe, and this is what I argued in an article for The Guardian right after the Labour Party lost the election, that it wasn't so much that the Labour Party hadn't embraced the wealth creators, business, that's who some of the people who were saying that, well, Labour people who were saying that the Labour Party lost because they hadn't embraced business enough. I thought actually that what we have, but this is true, I think, across the world, is not enough progressive thinking on how to actually talk about the wealth creation process in a radically different way as a collective enterprise, and hence also think of the distribution process as not just a redistribution process, but in fact a dynamic that should be linked to our understanding of this collective wealth creation. Anyway, I'll come back to this at the end. And this, I will have something at the end to say about the Google tax bill and why it's too low, but I want to relate it back to this discussion. I'm just putting it here just in case any of you are going to be burning with the question. Just remember they're going to probably answer it anyway. Anyway, so what I want to do is kind of go down. I'm going to spend quite a bit of time on this whole kind of innovation-led growth stuff because that's my expertise, and it's always good to talk about what you know. I also want to talk about the whole green agenda, and I want to come to this whole issue of inclusive growth precisely because of what I just said, which is we absolutely need to learn how to talk about distribution, equality, and inequality as tied to our understanding of value creation. Otherwise, what we have is all this talk about, you know, the speculators as bad, you know, the value extractors, but that hasn't been tied to a different understanding of the value creation process itself. I talk way too much and too fast, sorry, but that's both because I'm Italian and Italians talk too fast, and I grew up in New York, and in New York they talk too fast. So two negatives, unfortunately, don't make a positive in that case. Anyway, so the first thing is simply, and this is, it actually is important to go into some of the history, otherwise you could just say, well, okay, fine, you know, why should I believe her? Is if you actually ask yourself about, you know, the important big innovations that have occurred, and always remember that all these innovations had both a supply push, but also a demand pull, bold policies that actually allowed, for example, mass production to actually get fully deployed and diffused throughout the whole economy, which hopefully we can talk about later. What we don't kind of get a sense of is the degree to which this market failure framework actually allows us to explain, you know, these, if you want, revolutionary changes. And again, always think both supply and demand side. And by demand side, I mean, again, policies which, things like suburbanization for mass production. And what we see here, and this is very important, is that the in places and the few places in the world that actually achieve this kind of smart innovation-led growth, like Silicon Valley, but I would argue today, China, certain parts of Germany, Denmark, Finland, Brazil up until the stalemate that occurred a year ago, what we see is this active role of a decentralized network of different types of public agencies across the entire innovation chain. And why do I sort of stress the word entire? Because as I mentioned before, the market failure framework, which is important, it is useful, but it's not enough, at best can kind of explain that early stage upstream, you know, investment in the science, which again is very important, but most of us know that. What we haven't given credit to all these different public agencies, and I focus here on the US, why? Not because it's more important than any other country, but because unfortunately people often use the whole Silicon Valley metaphor then to import really stupid policies because they didn't understand what happened in Silicon Valley. What we have is this network of different public agencies across that whole chain, so basic research, applied research, and even the early stage financing of the companies themselves. Let me see if, it's two graphs, two figures for now. And there's two things I want to say about this. First, what I've just said, that it was occurred throughout the whole chain. But two, that these agencies, if you actually look at their website, so how they describe themselves, they're absolutely quite explicit about this market-shaping, market-creating role, of course, using their own language, but this mission-orientedness of the important agencies, whether it was DARPA around the internet, of course, all the NASA investments, but think of the BBC in this country, which has been absolutely fundamental for not only creating public broadcasting, but also investing in areas, whether it was the BBC Micra, the iPlayer, but also having a notion of public value and social value, which went beyond this kind of narrow notion of the public good in economics. This has actually been fundamental to the success of these agencies, also in terms of the talent that they were able to recruit. This is really important. Would you want to go work for a government department that describes itself as just administering, de-risking, leveraging, fixing different types of market failures? Probably not. And one of the most important lessons that people haven't learned about the US up until recently, because the US, and this is also very important, is no longer actually producing this kind of ecosystem, and we can, again, come to that later if we have time, has been that by having these mission-oriented agencies, it's been an honor to work for them. So the US Department of Energy, for example, up until 6 months ago, was run by a Nobel Prize-winning physicist, right? A Nobel Prize winner running a government department. His name was Steve Chu, and he set up ARPA-E, which I have up here as one of the examples. So it's the sister city in the Department of Energy of DARPA, which is in the Department of Defense, because he thought it was an honor also to be guiding, in some ways, Obama's stimulus program, right? $800 billion focused, initially was also greatly focused around green. Then because of the Tea Party stalemate, things had to change a bit, but still $800 billion of the American Recovery Act. A lot of it was actually then administered through the Department of Energy. There's a great book about this called The New New Deal. And of course it's an honor to work in those kind of agencies. So there's a self-fulfilling prophecy that the more we bash the state, and don't forget David Cameron's great quote when he first entered the coalition government, civil servants are the enemies of enterprise, he said. There's this self-fulfilling prophecy that the more we bash the state, the more we have difficulty imagining a positive, strategic, mission-oriented, strategic state, the harder it is also to recruit sort of highly talented people in those organizations, and also the more difficulty these organizations themselves have to actually deal with the big challenges of the future. The whole outsourcing process itself, in some ways, has been, you can almost see it as a conspiracy, even though I don't believe in conspiracies, because the more you hurt the ability of public agencies to actually build their own capacity and competencies, the harder it will be for those agencies themselves, again, to deal with the dynamic forces in capitalism, as well as even just recognize future opportunities when they arise. And of course, when we set up these famous public-private partnerships, the public side ends up being too weak. It no longer has, if you want, this directional quality and just sees its role as de-risking. Now, I mentioned that you need to look at the whole chain. So I said early stage high-risk finance. And the reason I've put this graph here to just both show you the numbers, and this is showing a particular program in the US called Small Business Innovation Research Program. In the UK, we copied it without being very creative. We call it SBRI, inverted the last two letters. This program has been absolutely important for actually giving finance to companies themselves that were chosen. This whole worry we have about picking winners versus just kind of leveling this basic playing field is a false worry all around the world. So in Israel, we have Yozma, which gives public finance to companies. All around the world, the most innovative companies have actually required this patient, long-term, committed finance, which often has come from the public sector. So what this graph does is compares private venture capital funding in the US versus this kind of, I can't really call it, does someone have to vote? No. private versus public venture capital, even though this isn't really a public venture capital program, but it's public high-risk financing. And what's interesting is if you look at the numbers where the white and grayish is private and the darker colors are public, is the difference between them actually grew over time. And if you know anything about venture capital, this won't surprise you. So venture capital, of course, is important. Of course it's important and has been important in Silicon Valley. However, it's very exit-driven. And they want that exit to happen in kind of 3 to 5 years max, increasingly more like three, through an IPO or a buyout. And that's all fine. But that famous Death Valley phase in the middle of that innovation chain, when companies themselves actually require finance to then engage with these big new challenges like the whole climate change investment process, because of course that climate change requires investment in energy, renewable energy, R&D, they have required this kind of patient finance. And this is also important to emphasize that the words we use to talk about finance, things like the credit crunch or, you know, small firms don't have enough finance, that's not really right. There's plenty of finance out there. There's even too much finance. We don't have the right kind of finance. We don't have enough of this patient, long-term, committed finance. And if anything, the types of finance that we did have, if you just, again, look at those numbers, how they've changed over time, in the private financial sector have become increasingly short-term, as so this kind of need for these public programs to enter has become, has, if anything, increased, even in the US. So this is the theatrical bit that I usually say, if you don't like what I'm saying, then throw away your smartphone. Why? Not because the government invented your iPhone. Of course not. We know the history of Steve Jobs and his company and all the great people who worked with him, including Sir John Ives. Of course, those people in Apple continue to be inspiring, very important. But what we haven't had, if you want, is a narrative, a vocabulary to talk about the role of the public sector in actually allowing your smartphone to be smart and not stupid. Had we just in the US, but again, these are now global players and technologies are emerging globally, if we just had a state that leveled the playing field, invested in some infrastructure and science, and then got out of the way, what The Economist was telling us in the beginning there, when I said we have an ideological problem, we would not have had any of the technologies in your smartphones, which required direct, not indirect, direct investments in particular areas. Apple itself received a type of early stage high risk finance, not SBIR, but SBIC. And this again required all sorts of picking of these areas. But what I said before, this kind of mission orientedness of these investments, what I meant, and I perhaps should have emphasized a bit more, is, you know, so many of these technologies, if you just look at how many times the word NASA shows up, or different types of DOD, unfortunately, Department of Defense investments, this is because they often came out of these missions like going to the moon, right? Now, forget whether going to the moon was a good idea or a bad idea. I'm sure people have an opinion on that, especially because now apparently they also want to, you know, go to Mars. But the point is, this was not about just fixing a little problem in a sector. Many of these investments were spillovers from kind of the ability to dream big. Then, of course, what we dream about, whether it's going to the moon or solving climate change or battling the aging crisis, say, that we have, which of course also requires all sorts of technologies, should be democratically debated. It should be part of the discussion, but the dismissing of the public sector as just being there in the background and not having been fundamental for the actual technologies themselves, which also drive the profits of many of these companies, right? So, and again, I'll come back to this, but you know, Google's algorithm was funded by the public sector through the National Science Foundation. The fact that we can't talk about government as investors, having actually had to think about this wide group of different options it's had and had to actually almost think of it like a portfolio, and only talk about government as spending, regulating, administering, de-risking, leveraging, you could just go on and on, which misses any of this. So we have an 800-page book on Steve Jobs, where not one page, not one paragraph, not one sentence, not one word has any mention of any of these public investments, whether it was DARPA, the internet, the Navy for GPS, the CIA for your touchscreen. Yes, start worrying every time you do, you know, fool around with your stuff. And Siri, the voice-activated system, also financed by DARPA. You know, these were massive waves of financing which these entrepreneurs, who are important, of course, were able to surf. And here's the wave, literally, it looks like one, in the life sciences area, right? So luckily, these investments have not just focused on the military-industrial complex. This is usually the first question. Oh, you're just talking about the military-industrial complex. No, luckily, the lessons from these mission-oriented, unfortunately, defense-driven kind of investments was learned in health as well as in energy. These numbers here are from the National Institutes of Health, which in the US have been spending billions over decades. Just last year, $32 billion. Am I exaggerating? Yeah, $30.9 billion in 2012. I think last year was $31.5 billion. Even under Reagan, you know, these investments increased. This is actually the first time in US history where some of these investments from the NSF, the NIH, NASA itself are under threat. Again, let's just call it the sort of, you know, Tea Party kind of discussion that started in the US Congress about 2 years ago. This is really the first time in its history where Congress itself is actually debating whether or not to continue these cycles. But the point is, this kind of investment created a way for the whole biotech sector to actually be formed. The venture capital industry only entered biotechnology in the 80s, after decades of investment from the public sector. And what's interesting, I keep mentioning this direct, not indirect. What I mean is, not just through tax incentives. Right? This notion that we just need to facilitate the life of Pfizer or Glaxo or Vodafone or, you know, Google misses the point that actually these companies have benefited from not just different types of tax incentives, but direct investments that government has had to make, which, by the way, many fail. Any venture capitalist will tell you that many investments fail when you have to make bets on particular areas, right? And I'll come to this later when I argue that what, you know, we haven't done, if you want, is actually set this up properly, like a portfolio, so some of the upside can also come back to fund the downside. But before we go into that, just reflect on these figures, which really show the huge differences between countries in the degree to which they are supporting the R&D process inside business, which we know is a fundamental driver of long-run growth, and hence long-run profit formation for the companies, between those countries that are doing it directly, for example, through these SBIR kind of schemes, versus indirectly through tax incentives, whether it be an R&D tax credit or something like the patent box, which in this country, GlaxoSmithKline alone basically lobbied into law, which is a real problematic tax policy. Why? Because what we know about R&D spending in business is what drives those investments are not just, you know, making R&D easier, right? It's the perception of where the future opportunities are in an area. And in fact, the role that these direct investments have played is precisely to create new landscapes funded through this long-run patient finance in the public sector, with business only coming in later. So what we end up having is those countries that have relied too much on these indirect mechanisms, these different types of tax incentives, it's not surprising then that they have, say, below average business R&D spending, because that's not what drives R&D spending. Of course, tax incentives are important at some levels, and we must also create smart tax incentives, for example, targeting the labor that's hired to do the R&D versus the income that's generated. But this whole notion that somehow you can just facilitate that process is, you know, just has very little empirical evidence. And there's this great quote, it's way too long, but it's just such a beautiful quote, I want to put it up here. Because Keynes actually kind of talked about this indirectly. He didn't talk much about innovation, but there's this wonderful letter that he wrote to Roosevelt where they were both really struggling with the post-Depression era in the UK and the US. And Keynes is like, you know what, we got a problem. You know, I use this word animal spirits and it makes you think of tigers and lions and wolves. But unfortunately, lots of these businesses are just domesticated animals. They're kind of gerbils and hamsters and pussycats. And so the policy process is so different, the policy-making process. If you had a lion in a cage that wanted to roar, already had its animal spirits, then of course you could just sit back and say, well, let me just facilitate their life and get away, you know, get all these impediments away. So get rid of the red tape, create some tax incentives. If in that cage you have a hamster, a gerbil, or a pussycat, and you need to make it grow up into a lion, of course, you know, the kind of policy intervention is very different. It requires this kind of direct creation of new landscapes, which actually get up the willingness and ability for that lion to roar instead of assuming that. Unfortunately, the Keynesians themselves, I don't think, have understood this. Lots of stimulus programs, or I should put it this way, lots of Keynesian economics in the modern era has just focused on the need for government to step in and fix perhaps one of the biggest market failures, which is the pro-cyclical nature of business, right? Investing too much in the boom, too little in the bust. And so you need stimulus just to enter when we enter the bust, so recessions don't turn into depressions. Extremely important lesson, which worldwide we've had a hard time remembering recently, and that's why for the first time since the Great Depression, we've recently had depressions, right? So very important point in Keynes. However, it's not enough. All the investments I've been talking about, so all those general purpose technologies that have really created decades of growth in the last 200 years, all the technologies that I mentioned were directly financed through different types of public agencies, happened in the boom. We need a theory of the state and the policymaking process even in the boom. And again, this doesn't mean, don't get me wrong, this is not just about high-tech technology and robots or whatever, right? Don't forget the word debate, right? Because it's taxpayer-funded, we obviously need a discussion about what areas, shale gas, by the way, fracking, was almost all government-funded for 30 years before the private sector came in. So none of this should be seen as kind of a hyping up of the role of technology. Technologies themselves are the outcomes of choices being made by these different agents, public and private, but this directionality which the public sector has provided, precisely because it's been dismissed, has also then not nurtured enough of a debate, if you want, amongst the populace about the different choices we have. And that's also why so many electoral debates are so boring, because we don't talk about this kind of co-creation of future opportunities, what should be co-created in the future through these types of investments. I'm allowed to use the word pigs because I'm Italian. It's a terrible word that Goldman Sachs coined to talk about Portugal, Italy, Greece, and Spain. If you had a German up here with the word pigs here, you know, it would not be a good scene if there were Greeks or Italians like me in the audience. But you know, there's been a complete misunderstanding of everything I've just said, because if you look at these numbers here, so the business spending on R&D, not only is it too low in countries that don't have enough government spending in those areas, which crowd in, if you want, the private sector, but also what we see is those countries that have had the hardest time after the crisis were precisely those countries that were not investing enough. This notion that somehow they were all just spending way too much in all these different areas and so they have to cut is actually also just wrong statistically. You can see this, I think I took the numbers out because I had too many slides, and in fact I have way too many slides and I have about five more minutes. Countries like Italy, in fact, have had low deficits for something like 20 years, right? Now, if you are not investing in any of the areas that I've been talking about, and this just kind of broadened out those areas, human capital formation, education, R&D, and mission-oriented R&D. This is not just background science, right? And having an eye on that whole innovation chain in different areas, which include these social areas, whether we're talking about aging or other areas, which in the European Commission they talk about as these big societal challenges, then you're not going to have growth. And what matters is the debt-to-GDP ratio, not the deficit itself. So this is why, and The Economist actually woke up to this recently, this is why we actually have had rising debt-to-GDP, I can't speak, rising debt-to-GDP in countries which also have had, you know, pretty low deficit levels. Because what matters is not necessarily exactly what number, you 2%, 3%, 4% deficit, but what you're spending on and how you're spending on it. This notion that it's somehow austerity versus infrastructure, infrastructure is the magic bullet, just build a few bridges and roads, is also wrong, right? Infrastructure itself, historically, has had the most effect and created the most spillovers between sectors when it was also part of a mission. Just think of Germany's Energiewende policy today, which is not just about renewable energy, it's about greening the entire economy, and all of their infrastructure budget is very much aligned with that mission. Let me just say quickly with sustainable growth and green growth, simply that what's happening there is exactly what we saw happening in biotech, nanotech, and IT, which is all the really difficult parts of those investments in green, so highly capital intensive, high technological and market risk, so the upper right-hand quadrant there, have almost been completely devoid of private finance. I won't bore you with the figures, but one very interesting thing we have today worldwide in the green emergence of the green economy is this role, for example, of public banks. These are the development banks I've put up here. They're basically just four. There's the Chinese one, the Brazilian one, the German one, and the European level, EIB, and together they are investing something like four times as much as the entire worldwide private sector. Is this good, is this bad? Who knows? Do we have a way to talk about it? No. These are the figures of the German bank, which is not only playing this Keynesian counter-cyclical role, which is important, so the private banks withdrew the loans after the crisis, this public bank massively increased loans after the crisis, right, counter-cyclical public bank, but it also directed that financing around what we call climate finance. Well, is that scary? Yes, it's very scary to economists who don't have a way to talk about this need to tilt the playing field towards these missions. This is not about financing just wind or just solar. This is about financing this green transformation of the entire economy. As I mentioned, the Chinese bank is one of the leading players. If you look at these numbers, they'll scare the hell out of you. This one public bank giving things like quantities like $9 billion to single companies, some of which go bust, some don't. But guess what? The same thing is happening in the US. Elon Musk, the next big hero after Steve Jobs, $5 billion from the US government just to his SpaceX and Tesla. Tesla, $465 million guaranteed loan just to that one little model of the Tesla car. Do we have, again, you know, a discussion about that? Do we have a recognition of that public investment, hence risk-taking process with Tesla? Of course not. Do we know about other companies that receive something like, say, what Tesla got but failed? Of course we do, because we talk about that as government being stupid, government picking winners, government being inept. Why did government give Solyndra $500 million, right? There was that whole Solyndra discussion in the US without any discussion of how that had actually been part of the portfolio process. Of funding, you know, shale, nuclear, some solar, some wind, making lots of different bets, of which some would necessarily fail. And this is what I want to come to now, this inability to talk about the public sector as necessarily requiring this investment process, as well as, of course, its other very important role, for example, of redistributing wealth, which I'll come to in a minute, has then created this dysfunctional dynamic where we only socialize risks and not rewards. Why is that? Well, just think of one of the most important curves, figures in Piketty's great book. Is he gonna give one of these talks or not? Good. so he'll put up the exact numbers. You know, this famous U-shape. Well, what actually happened in the 70s, right? So one of his conclusions in the book is, of course, that we need different types of taxation to get rid of this rising inequality. But what he doesn't talk about is why, you know, what actually happened to tax after the 1970s? And by the way, this was just as worse in the UK. In fact, in some ways worse, depending on how you look at these figures. What happened after the 1970s that made inequality rise so much? Well, we need to talk to a very famous communist called Warren Buffett, who's one of the smartest people out there in terms of talking about this opportunity creation process, where he singles out what happened in the 1970s. Capital gains tax fell by 50% in 5 years, right? This is a tax, as you know, which shouldn't necessarily be very low because, in fact, it's by having it so low, in some ways it's rewarding short-term investments instead of long-run ones. All sorts of people have talked about this, from Adair Turner, John Kay. But why did capital gains tax fall by 50%? It was the National Venture Capital Association that had just formed in the US. And part of this rhetoric of, we are the innovators, we are the entrepreneurs, we are the risk takers, right? And the public sector is just there to facilitate you, actually enabled them to very successfully lobby in a very short period of time for this change, which Piketty himself talks about, the whole capital gains tax changes in different countries, as one of the lead causes of inequality. In the UK, it was the Labour Party that had that bright idea. They reduced the time that private equity, has to be invested from 10 years to 2 years in order to make the economy more dynamic. This was under Gordon Brown's leadership of the Treasury. Now, you know, where they get that idea from. So again, this notion that we just need lots of finance and let's make life easier for finance and this is somehow going to spur innovation. Well, Warren Buffett here tells you what that led to, just a lot of job losses. Or put it another way, it definitely didn't do anything for VC, because if you look at where VC has invested, venture capital has invested, it has had almost nothing to do with tax. It's always been following these, if you want, mission-oriented public investments. Now, one of the key causes of inequality, I would argue, are this lack, and this is why this whole thing that you guys just did recently, which caused all sorts of problems in the media of the dividend, forcing companies to behave in a certain way or something else. Well, these kinds of deals, right, between government and business, where government says, hey, right, because you're actually benefiting from our investments, let's make a deal, which is not about getting captured, business getting captured, but a healthy symbiotic relationship, is in fact what explains some of the most dynamic and innovative private sector investments in R&D. So these two famous private R&D labs, Xerox PARC and Bell Labs inside of AT&T, the Bell Labs one is fascinating if you look at the history, emerged as an outcome of a tense deal with the state. So you had AT&T that was a monopoly, and government saying, you know what? You are monopoly, you know, you are state-granted monopoly. You're going to reinvest your profits back into the real economy, back into innovation, and back into big innovation. And that's where Bell Labs was, came out of. And the degree to which we don't have those deals today, and why that also explains this, if you want, ultra-financialization of many companies which are choosing to spend many of their profits on areas like share buybacks, instead of, if you want, real economy investments in R&D or human capital formation. Huge amounts, by the way, in the UK, in the US, across Europe. So just the Fortune 500 companies have spent $3 trillion on buying back your own shares, which boosts your stock price, boosts your stock option, boosts executive pay. This problem, if you want, can both be understood in terms of the whole deregulation of the financial sector and its influence on the real economy, but also on this lack of deal making, right? Share buybacks at the level that they are being used today were actually illegal before the 1980s. We also have record level hoarding, so inert capital in Europe and in the US, and the degree to which there isn't this healthy, symbiotic, kind of tense public-private ecosystem today, I think, is to blame. And so in order to get this inclusive growth, in order to get, if you want, the profits that are generated, that are co-created between public and private sectors to actually create, if you want, a more circular economy and also a revolving fund, we absolutely need to, if you want, rethink the role of policy, not just in terms of what I said in the beginning from market fixing to market making, but let's just get over some of the hysteria around things like picking winners. We have to pick. We have to make choices. But how can we make those choices? How can we make sure we have a real discussion about what the future missions should be? How do we talk about directionality? How do we evaluate these investments? Just think about the BBC Charter Review. The BBC absolutely, in the UK, has pushed the frontier of the market in different areas, created huge amounts of spillovers. There's some great reports on this, including one by Nesta. some years ago. But we don't have a way then to evaluate its impact. We say the BBC should stay in its little area. Again, just think of the innovation chain I put up before, of, you know, ballets or documentaries on giraffes, but God forbid, don't start making soap operas or talk shows. You're going out of your little area, right? That's for the private sector. This notion that you have a bit of the market for the private sector and a bit of it just to be fixed by the public sector would have never allowed us to, if you want, have in this country such a mission-oriented, strategic, successful talent, if you want, attracting agency like the BBC. But we need to be able to measure it. And if you look at the problems with the charter review, and I've written about this in an LSE blog, if you're interested, it's been this inability to talk about or to even measure what the BBC has done in the past. We need to build explorative organizations in the public sector. I come from Italy. Of course I know that the state all over the world is not this kind of mission-oriented, strategic, great state. Of course there's bureaucracy. Of course there's also capture. But what we should be doing, instead of just cutting the state's capacity, not just in terms of budget, but also the outsourcing of the brains, we should have a real discussion of how to build new thinking, new ways to dream also within public organizations that are able to explore, welcome the trial and error process, but also share in the risks and rewards. So the fact that, for example, we are fearful of any government equity and any investment is really coming from this problematic framework that we have of market fixing. By the way, in Israel, they have Yasma, which does retain equity. Citra in Finland, which invested in Nokia, for example, also retained equity. This is not about sort of socialism or capitalism. This is how to actually distribute also the investments in such a way that they also admit that it was, if you want, a public sector portfolio creation. So if you're only picking up and covering the downside, the Solyndras, the Concords, without also getting the upside, you know, this is a problem. And it used to happen through tax. What was the top marginal rate when NASA was formed under Republican General Eisenhower? 91%, right? That was the top marginal rate in the US under Republican military general, okay? Now, this is not to say we should go back to this rate or that rate, but the point is the tax system today still working to bring back that public return? Of course, there's huge improvements to be made there, and areas like the capital gains tax should be reviewed. But, you know, if we want to have this kind of mission-oriented strategic agency, we should also be thinking of different types of schemes, including not just giving away the entire IPR and the patent. We might want to retain every now and then a golden share of some of the IPR. There's a whole list of things we could do. Income contingent loans, like we do with students, why not for business? I don't want to point to any one solution, but even just asking that question requires starting to think again completely on what the role is of the public sector in this co-creation alongside the private sector of wealth and how to make sure we distribute those gains in such a way that reflects that collective wealth-creating process. I've gone over, I'm really sorry.